The Japanese had surrendered, and now World War II in Asia was over. Then, Indonesian nationalist Sukarno proclaimed the Independent Republic of Indonesia, but the Dutch did not accept this, and they tried to retake the colony by force. And so, the Indonesian War of Independence started. During this conflict, both sides committed war crimes. In this video, we're going to take a look at the Dutch war crimes that were committed during this conflict. Good to have you back on the channel. If you're new, my name is Stefan. I'm a history teacher from the Netherlands and I'm hustling history for you. And if you liked it, consider subscribing and also hit the notification bell. After centuries of colonization by the Dutch East India Company, the VOC, and its bankruptcy near the end of the 18th century, the Dutch East Indies was established in 1816. A colony was owned by the Dutch state. Over the course of the 19th and the early 20th century, the Dutch completed their territorial conquest of the East Indies and laid the foundation of what later would become Indonesia. When nationalist movement emerged from the early 20th century, the Dutch responded with oppression. Near the end of 1941, the Japanese Empire launched its conquest of Southeast Asia. In March 1942, the Dutch colonial army, the KNIL, and the Dutch governor general surrendered, and thus, the Japanese occupation of Indonesia had begun. This occupation would last till August 1945. Millions of Indonesians and many Dutch would not live to see this. Indonesians because of famine and forced labor, and the Dutch because of the abysmal conditions in the Japanese internment camps where men, women and children were interned, part of them in the camps and part of them outside of the camps, as well as Dutch men and POWs who were put to forced labor just as the Indonesians. The sudden Japanese defeat created a power vacuum and Indonesian nationalists now stepped in. Nationalist leader Sukarno declared Indonesian independence on the 17th of August 1945. After this, the British had landed in the Javanese city of Surabaya to disarm the Japanese, and this led to a violent clash with Indonesian nationalists who went on a killing spree. During this so-called Bersiap, Indonesian youngsters known as Pemudas slaughtered thousands of Europeans and Indo-Europeans. Meanwhile, the Dutch government in exile had prepared to restore Dutch colonial rule. The British pressured the Dutch to start negotiations with the Indonesian nationalists about a transition towards independence. Negotiations started, and in 1946 the Linggadjati Agreement was signed. Both parties weren't happy. In the meanwhile, the Dutch had shipped 150,000 soldiers, most of them draftees, to the Indonesian archipelago. In 1947, the Dutch launched Operation Product. This was known as the first police action, Politionele Actie. The Indonesian nationalists resorted to guerrilla warfare. Eventually, the Dutch would launch a second action in 1948. The United States forced the Dutch to cease hostilities, or else they would stop the Marshall Aid, the aid that was so vital for the Dutch economy to recover after the war. On the 27th of December 1949, the Dutch accepted Indonesian independence. 20 years later, there was an investigation about the Dutch war crimes during this conflict, and it resulted in the so-called Excessor Nota. Excess Memorandum. It was concluded that war crimes were committed, but these were mere incidents. Historian Remy Limpach did some extensive research, which he presented in 2016, and he stated, "This study, the Excess Memorandum, makes it clear that this claim does not hold. The extreme Dutch violence clearly did not involve a few incidental cases or regrettable exceptions. Dutch soldiers were structurally guilty of mass violence, and certain units did this systematically. The latter means that excessive force was part of a strategy, a system. Mass violence was an integral part of the overarching colonial policy." Limpach makes a distinction between the different army formations of the Dutch. The regular units of the Royal Netherlands Army, as well as the Royal Netherlands East Indies Army and the Marine Brigade, did indulge themselves in structural violence. However, the commandos, they indulge themselves in systematic violence. You may ask yourself, what is the difference? Well, structural violence becomes systematic violence when it's used according to a fixed pattern and as a strategy. So let's take a look at some case studies. The most notorious was the South Celebes affair. This occurred on the island that is now known as Sulawesi. The colonial authorities showed how far they were willing to go to restore colonial rule. Mass murder was masked as a military action. The Dutch authorities, they issued summary law. It meant that basically, the Dutch soldiers could execute everyone they deemed to be guilty of resistance, POWs and civilians alike. However, regular KNIL units were involved. Most of this was carried out by commandos, special forces who in 1946-47 acted as death squads. The mid-1946 formed units, commandos, the Green Beret, the paratroopers, the Red Beret, and the Corps Special Forces, Corps Speciale Truppen, were sent to South Celebes to restore order with the utmost severity. The South Celebes affair was a series of executions that was carried out by the special forces from December 1946 to February 1947. At least 3,500 Indonesian men lost their lives, but presumably more. Indonesian sources state 40,000 were killed. Led by Captain Raymond Wesseling, the soldiers went from village to village to capture resistant fighters or alleged enemies and execute them. There are many prisoners who were tortured in order to gain information and also executed without a trial. Westerling would later stage a coup against Sukarno, which failed. Sometimes dubbed as the Dutch My Lai, the Rabagede massacre occurred in December 1947 on the island of Java. In the morning of the 9th of December 1947, 80 to 90 Dutch KL soldiers captured the village of Rabagede. The soldiers were looking for a local resistance leader who most likely had already left the village. The Dutch soldiers massacred hundreds of male citizens of the village. Sources give different numbers, 312, 431 and 433. Just like the My Lai massacre, which occurred during the Vietnam War, the Rabagede massacre initially didn't draw much attention. Well, it took a while. It was only in 2007 when a Dutch student wrote a thesis about this topic. It later gained further attention in 2011 when the widows of the men that were massacred in 1947 sued the Dutch government, who had to pay reparations. In Chililito, in western Java, was an important airbase, and this airbase was surrounded by resistance fighters. It was in enemy territory. The local commander, Henry Schrijvers, he had to maintain order. Peace and order needed to be maintained, and thus the Dutch had to be vigilant at all times. Dutch Sergeant Major Henry Schrijvers, he had to make sure of this. In a war against an invisible enemy, Schrijvers relied on a network of informants. Later, captured enemies were a source of information. But the colonial judicial system got overloaded, and as a result of this, many prisoners went out free. This frustrated Schrijvers greatly, and thus he gave the order to murder several prisoners. As one Dutch soldier who was stationed at the airbase wrote in his diary, "Dozens of extremists are shot every day here at the airfield. Carrying weapons is punishable by death. Recently, shots were fired from a kampong. The kampong was flattened and 300 men were finished." Now, how many people died as a result of the reign of terror that was carried out at the Chililiton airbase is hard to say. The violence at the airport is representative for numerous other unexplained cases of Dutch mass violence. In 1949, near the end of the Indonesian War of Independence, 16 Indonesian prisoners, POWs, were murdered by the Dutch in the East Javanese city of Malang. The reason why I point this out is that the Dutch military police started an investigation after these murders. And this resulted into the documentation of the planning, the execution, and the eventual cover-up by the perpetrators. By 1949, the Dutch were drawn into the defense. The city of Malang was constantly harassed by Indonesian nationalists, and the Dutch men that were stationed there, they were on edge. Morale was low, and the local commander, Colonel Kreunig, he decided to execute 16 POWs. Now, eventually, he designated them as resistance leaders, but this was very unlikely since one of the executed was 16 years old. Later, the colonel stated that this was the only way. Perhaps even more tragic was the so-called blood wedding, which occurred on Cilacap, central Java, mid-1949. It started with a patrol of 20 conscript soldiers who saw a gathering. They surrounded the gathering and it turned out to be a wedding. The Dutch lieutenant who commanded this patrol whispered to one of his men that they had to hold fire. The lieutenant then disappeared and he walked into the crowd. Then shots were being heard. The soldiers believed that their commander was in danger and they opened fire at the crowd. 14 men, 11 women and one child were killed. Dozens were injured. The lieutenant who survived it, he reported the incidents. Now, this incident showed that these killings were not premeditated, but the lack of discipline and poor leadership quality resulted in these killings. All in all, we can conclude that there was a culture of lawlessness among the Dutch soldiers. Combined with low morale, stress, and sometimes racist viewpoint, it led to disproportionate violence where kampongs were burned down or flattened by artillery, where there was looting, torture during interrogation, summary executions, liquidations, and sometimes rape. According to Dutch historian Gert Oostindie, and yeah, I know his name literally means East Indie, how ironic, it is hard to determine how many Indonesians were killed by the Dutch mass violence, simply due to the fact that much of it was not reported or covered up later. He assumes that tens of thousands were killed. When it comes down to regular combat, more than 150,000 Indonesians were killed. But bear in mind that also many Indonesians got killed because of internal violence. Because yes, also the Indonesians committed war crimes. And why was that? I hope to cover that in the future. And what about the Dutch? I mean, not all Dutch soldiers were war criminals. Many were appalled by what happened. Did they protest? And what happened after that? Well, these are all topics we can discuss, just as the underlying causes of why this violence took place. If you would find it interesting, leave a comment below. Big shout out to my patrons and a special thanks to Janusz Dojankiewicz, Joan, Justin Trebell, Peter King, Tanya Dixie, Henry Clarkson, Rob Park, Andrea Martic, and Fernando Lopez Ojeda. If you like to learn about the Dutch colonial army, click here. If you like to learn about the Dutch colonization of Indonesia, how that all went, you can click right here. I want to thank you for watching and see you later.